Okay, next morning
Next
and good evening,
morning.
everyone. Okay, welcome again to our sharing on the goodness of glutathione. And tonight's topic is glutathione for eye, brain health, and cognitive improvement. And first, we start with what is glutathione. And for decades, it has been known as this master antioxidant, superhero of antioxidants, and many other titles. Then later on, many other functions of glutathione were discovered, including being the most powerful detoxifier. And take note that glutathione is produced naturally within the body and is present in every cell. And these are the other important functions of glutathione. So apart from being the most important intracellular antioxidant for the cell, it's also a very powerful anti-inflammatory agent, very powerful immune booster modulator, very powerful detoxifier, and a very versatile signaling molecule for many cell systems. But these are only its main major functions. There are more than 100 other functions attributed to glutathione. This is the molecule of glutathione. It's made up of three amino acids, glutamic acid, and then you have cysteine in the center and glycine. Okay, you can see that in the center where cysteine is, that part with the sole sulfur atom. Okay, the sulfur atom attached to the hydrogen atom. The sulfur hydroxyl group is what gives glutathione its versatility, but also what makes glutathione fragile. And cysteine, which contributes that part, is also fragile because of that. The chemical short form for active or reduced glutathione is GSH. The G refers to the rest of the molecule, whereas SH refers to the sulfur hydroxyl group that I described just now, which is the sulfur atom and the hydrogen atom. Let's start with the benefits for the eyes. Glutathione protects the eyes from blindness, from glaucoma, from cataracts, and many other eye problems, and significantly protects age-related macular degeneration, AMD, which is the most common condition with glutathione protects against free radicals to which the eyes are directly exposed. Note that the eyes are the only organs not protected by skin. The rest of the body, either ordinary thick skin or thicker skin or thin skin, just like our lips, right? Still skin. The eyes cannot have any skin over it, otherwise the light would come in and we cannot see. Of course, once in a while, our eyelids blink. The sun rays penetrate the cornea into the inner structures, causing damage and degeneration. So the entire thickness of the eyeball can be damaged by the sun's rays. Let's go back to the structure of the eye. So you can see the entire thickness of the eye from the cornea through the lens, right into the body, right to then to the retina. All this can be reached by the sun's rays, especially the UVA, UVB, and over the long term can cause much damage. So without sufficient glutathione in the eyes protecting all the structures, we will all be blind. Okay? So very important that glutathione is the most important antioxidant protecting us from blindness, from cataracts, from glaucoma, from AMD, and many other eye problems. Now let's go to brain health and cognitive functions. Let us first define what we mean by cognitive functions. These are the conscious intellectual activities such as thinking, reasoning, or remembering that enable normal daily life. All this will gradually decrease with aging, but without affecting normal life, so it's still considered as part of normal aging. The moment all this affect your daily life, then you have jumped over, crossed over to dementia. Okay, so more rapid decline leading to moderate to severe impairment occur in neurodegenerative diseases, and there can be sudden and variable decline when there are injuries, stroke, and brain tumors. What are some of the types of brain disorders or diseases? You have the cerebral vascular diseases due to atherosclerosis. Then you can end up with ischemic or hemorrhagic stroke. And if there's arteriovenous malformation, then you can have a sudden hemorrhage. Then there are the neuropsychiatric dysfunction, which can lead to pain and migraine, anxiety and depression, and the autism spectrum disorder. And lastly, a big group of neurodegenerative diseases. And these are the diseases related to aging, but don't blame just aging alone. You do not have to end up with Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, and ALS if you age. Okay, it is not just due to aging. Many people live to 100 or more without all these diseases, but they are indeed due to degeneration, and degeneration occurs with aging, but there are other factors that cause the accelerated degeneration. So today, much of the discussion will be on this group of diseases. Okay. First, let's tackle the atherosclerosis and cerebrovascular disease and stroke. So progressive narrowing of carotid and cerebral blood vessels leads to reduced blood supply and progressive shrinkage of the brain. Right, there's estimated 1% shrinkage per year after age 50, and maybe more if you suffer from transient ischemic attacks or mini strokes. Okay, so 1% per year after 50, I am 67, so on the average, there's 17% shrinkage on the average. Okay, I believe politicians, they shrink more. Severe narrowing can lead to ischemic or occlusive stroke, and burst blood vessel, usually hypertensive with atherosclerosis or aneurysm, leads to hemorrhagic stroke, right? But most of the strokes are ischemic. Yeah, 90% are ischemic, 10% are hemorrhagic. So what is the role of glutathione in stroke rescue? Once a stroke occurs, both types, there is severe oxidative stress in the affected area. Untreated, this leads to extensive and possibly permanent brain damage. Immediate IV glutathione has been shown to protect the brain tissue from oxidative damage and prevent long-term sequelae. Continued boosting of glutathione is expected to hasten recovery. And therefore, having healthy levels of glutathione at the time of stroke may possibly reduce the severity of oxidative damage. Right? So remember this, if you ever get a stroke, right, you remember, you ask the doctor, please give me IV glutathione. It's not part of the current standard SOP. But since you have, you know, the science, you ask. Okay. Yeah? Yes, you can request. Right? If they say, oh, we don't have it, then you call me. Okay. But the point is, as a prevention, yeah, having healthy levels of glutathione all the time, and should you have a stroke, there's already a high level that protecting you. What about autism spectrum disorder? Patients with autism exhibit high levels of oxidative stress and inflammation, especially in the context of the brain, and the cellular damage caused by oxidative stress and inflammation may contribute to ASD symptoms. This may in part be attributable to the fact that production of glutathione is typically either impaired or otherwise inefficient in patients with ASD. Studies show that many autistic patients have defective genes related to one or more enzymes of the glutathione system. So because of this discovery, then many doctors treating autism spectrum disorder patients, then started using glutathione as part of the therapy. Autism is also associated with autoimmunity and the lack of immunoglobulins, which cause neural inflammation that correlates with the severity of symptoms. Glutathione can improve autoimmunity, and this aspect may explain the improvement of symptoms beyond the antioxidant and anti-inflammatory actions. Okay, so autism is associated with oxidative stress, with inflammation, and with autoimmunity, all of which are among the major functions of glutathione. Toxicity is another well-known risk for autism. So you add another important function of glutathione. So glutathione happens to be the body's main detoxification agent used by the liver, kidneys, and all organs to neutralize various toxins and contaminants, especially heavy metals. So using glutathione as therapy for autism, fighting oxidative damage, high glutathione levels may help prevent the following complications of autism. Epilepsy, about 1/3 of people with autism eventually develop epilepsy. Anxiety, depression, and reaction to the medications that they are on. Then we go to the large group, the neurodegenerative diseases, which can be considered as advanced brain aging or accelerated brain aging. We all age and our brains age, but not to the point that it affects our daily life. Cumulative oxidative stress, disrupted mitochondrial respiration, and mitochondrial damage are involved in various neurodegenerative disorders, including Alzheimer's disease, and DLB. DLB is dementia with Lewy bodies, also known as Lewy body dementia. And the two are the main causes of dementia. Of course, Alzheimer's disease is the number one cause. Also involved in Parkinson's and even schizophrenia. These changes to a lesser degree could also be responsible for the decline in cognitive functions in so-called normal aging. So the difference between dementia and Alzheimer's disease is that dementia is an overall term used to describe symptoms that impact memory, performance of daily activities, and communication abilities. Note that it is not part of normal aging. Okay? Alzheimer's disease is the most common type of dementia, right? Okay, so dementia is overall many types. Alzheimer's is the most common type. Alzheimer's disease gets worse with time and affects memory, language, and thought. While younger people can develop dementia or Alzheimer's disease, the risk increases as you age. People can have more than one type of dementia, that is the mixed dementia. Often, people with mixed dementia have multiple conditions that may contribute to the dementia. Diagnosis can only be confirmed at autopsy. Okay, so over the years, with this knowledge, then trying the boosting glutathione has been tried as a therapeutic strategy in Alzheimer's disease. What they have found is that glutathione is the most abundant endogenous antioxidant in the brain. Oxidative stress is a prominent feature of Alzheimer's disease. Therefore, elevation of glutathione in vivo protects brain against Alzheimer's disease relevant amyloid beta. Amyloid beta is the characteristic pathological finding for Alzheimer's disease. Elevation of glutathione in brain induces several protective pathways. Okay. Now, with that, if this was a patented drug, much more research would have been done and glutathione would be prescribed for all Alzheimer's disease by now. Right? But because it's not a drug, nobody is interested. Right? Cannot make, it's not a patented drug. Nobody is interested because it cannot make money. But since we know the science, we take advantage of this knowledge. Right? And we don't wait until we get Alzheimer's disease. When you get Alzheimer's disease, you won't know what to do anyway. Okay, so for ourselves, boost glutathione to help prevent Alzheimer's disease. And for our loved ones or relatives, you know that this is scientifically a valid strategy, then boost their glutathione to help delay or avoid Alzheimer's disease. Okay, another study, okay, shows that with millions of older individuals presently suffering from Alzheimer's disease worldwide, Alzheimer's disease is an unduly common form of dementia that exacts heavy toll on affected individuals and their families. And one of the emerging causative factors associated with Alzheimer's disease pathology is oxidative stress. And this Alzheimer's disease-related increase in oxidative stress has been attributed to decreased levels of the brain antioxidant glutathione. Okay, so it is an evidence-based strategy based on what is known about the pathology of Alzheimer's disease itself. So again, it's a pity the way the scientific world, the medical world is going, focus on drugs, natural things like glutathione is there, right? Ignore.
Sorry, doctor, just a question.
Yeah.
Here in the study, it says decreased levels of D brain antioxidant glutathione. Why is it called D brain antioxidant?
Okay, what it means, it is it's the main antioxidant protecting the brain. So it is called the brain antioxidant. Schizophrenia. Studies show a direct correlation with schizophrenia and decreased glutathione levels. Glutathione may slow down the progression and even lessen the side effects of the drugs given to treat this disease. So it has direct effect on the disease and also protects from the harm, side effects of the drugs used to treat the disease. Right? So it has multitasking. Parkinson's disease. It is a neurological disease affecting the substantia nigra, which is a small area of the cells in the midbrain. Degeneration of these cells as a result of free radical activity results in a reduction of cells, reduction in levels of the neurotransmitter dopamine, and upsets the balance between dopamine and another brain chemical, acetylcholine. The most familiar signs of the disease are tremor, a trembling in hands, arms, legs, jaw, face, a generalized slowness of movement, stiff limbs, rigid facial expressions, and problems with balance or gait. Depression often precedes the physical signs, and mental function can deteriorate in advanced cases, right? So they also can get dementia. So Parkinson's is not dementia, right? But Parkinson's, those with Parkinson can easily develop dementia. Yes?
Parkinson's doesn't go with age, even young people.
Similar to Alzheimer's disease, right? Young people can get, but of course, the more likelihood as you age. But young people is okay. The famous actor, quite young, huh? Okay, progression can be slow and symptoms managed with a variety of drugs, including L-DOPA and cenobamate. L-DOPA is converted to dopamine in the brain, and cenobamate prevents L-DOPA from being broken down before it reaches the brain. So these are medical treatments. So what is the role of glutathione? In Parkinson's disease, glutathione levels are reduced by 40 to 50% in the dopamine neurons. Some studies have shown that administering high-dose glutathione intravenously can help improve symptoms in Parkinson's patients. Okay, I'm not showing the video there, but in some longer talks, I show the video where you can see almost immediate improvement in some cases with high-dose glutathione IV. But the point is, that is already treatment. Better still, why not make sure you always have high levels of glutathione in the brain and avoid Parkinson's? Two clinical trials of IV glutathione have been conducted. The first reported in way back 1996 was open label. All 9 people with Parkinson's were aware they were given IV glutathione, and participants' motor symptoms improved, and this benefit lasted for 2 to 4 months. Following discontinuation of glutathione. The second study reported 2009 was a randomized controlled trial of 20 with Parkinson's disease. Half were given placebo, half were treated with IV glutathione. The therapy was shown to be safe, well tolerated, and possibly beneficial for symptoms. Now, 80 to 90% of Parkinson's patients treated with glutathione improved dramatically. Glutathione doesn't raise dopamine levels. It allows dopamine in the brain to become more effective. Glutathione can increase sensitivity to the neurotransmitter serotonin, which may explain why many depressed Parkinson's disease patients improve so markedly. In some cases, patients improve so dramatically that the dosage of the medication they take for the disease could be reduced. IV glutathione can be expensive, inconvenient, and associated with potential side effects. There are also other ways to give glutathione, for example, intranasal or using precursors that are less invasive and may be more effective. Early research efforts towards intranasal glutathione showed that it is safe, well tolerated, and raises levels of glutathione in the brain. IV glutathione can give high levels that can result in significant improvements. However, alternate day IV injections are very convenient. All right. So though in the for the people who use IV glutathione to treat Parkinson's, then there's high dose and alternate day. If high levels can be achieved via oral route, then treatment can be sustained long term, right? Because IV is very inconvenient. Sustained high levels may also prevent or delay Parkinson's and other neurodegenerative diseases and slow down aging. Unfortunately, oral glutathione is poorly absorbed. So what can we do? We'll come to that later. A little bit about the mitochondria. This is the energy powerhouse of the cell, and many diseases are now linked to mitochondrial dysfunction. So why we need to address the mitochondria? Because it produces energy and almost all of the cell's activities, functions require energy. Okay? And we look at the detail of some of the major neurodegenerative diseases, right? They're all related to mitochondrial dysfunction. Okay, what's underlying the mitochondrial dysfunction? Aging is associated with progressive mitochondrial dysfunction that occurs due to accumulation of mitochondrial DNA mutations, right? Our DNA undergoes mutations as we age from the effect of free radicals and the toxins. An increased reactive oxygen species production that causes oxidative damage to cellular macromolecules, thereby leading to reduced respiratory chain activity. That's the activity that produces energy and ATP generation. This affects all the organs, including the brain. Okay, so you can see there is mutations, and there is oxidative damage. Remember, glutathione is the body's best weapon against oxidative damage. So what happens to our glutathione levels as we age? Glutathione levels start to decrease at age 20 and goes down by 10 to 15% every decade. That results in oxidative stress when the levels go down significant enough, but not just oxidative stress, because of the major functions of glutathione, a significant reduction in its levels will also cause reduced immune function, increased toxicity, and increased inflammation. If we take at the level of 20 as being the baseline 100%, then with 10 to 15% decline every decade, this is the expected levels as you age. If you do not do anything to try to reverse the trend, and if your life includes all this, then the rate of decline is not average, will be faster, and you will be at the lower end of the percentages given just now. And we also know from research that most diseases are associated with glutathione depletion. A decrease in glutathione is a risk factor for chronic diseases that may be used to monitor the severity and progress of the diseases. Okay? And these diseases include the neurodegenerative diseases and diseases of the eye and other diseases related to brain health. Okay, so we have a solution for you. Prevention is better than cure. A boost glutathione before these diseases appear. So how to increase glutathione? Be reminded that glutathione taken orally is not well absorbed, so therefore we need to supplement with glutathione precursors or boosters. And the most important precursor is cysteine. Remember, there are three precursors, the three amino acids that make up glutathione: glutamic acid, cysteine, and glycine. Glutamic acid and glycine are abundant in foods unless you're severely malnourished, you should have enough of them in your body. But not so for cysteine. It is least available in the foods and is also fragile, easily denatured by cooking, for example, by heat. So we need to provide a stable form of cysteine. And the best form of this stable form of cysteine is ribosine. So what is ribosine? Ribosine is a patented nutrient made of D-ribose and L-cysteine. It is actually D-ribose L-cysteine or ribocysteine and trademarked as ribosine, trademarked by Max International, which does the research on this subject. And D-ribose L-cysteine is actually an invention of Max International's scientists, Dr. Herbert Nagasawa. Cysteine, which is stable and easily absorbed and utilized by the body, then is used by the cells to make glutathione. And the ribose, which is used to stabilize cysteine, is also useful to make the ATP. And the extra energy provided by the ATP then can be used to power the synthesis of glutathione, the manufacture of glutathione. So ribosine is a special precursor. It provides the cysteine and also provides the means to provide the energy to make glutathione, which is why our studies show that ribosine is 300% better than NAC, which is the second best glutathione precursor. A little bit about ribose. Ribose is the main component of ATP, which is the energy carrying molecule. And with extra ribose, you can expect improved blood flow in hearts and muscles, enhanced energy recovery in heart and muscles, protects heart from stress and exertion, and enhanced mitochondrial function. Okay, so another synergy. Glutathione protects the mitochondria from damage from oxidative stress. Okay. ATP enhances the mitochondrial function. All right, mitochondria produces ATP, but its own function requires energy. Okay. And that ATP will enable enhanced glutathione production, which means better function of all organs, including the brain. So ribosine is not just another glutathione precursor, right? It provides cysteine to make glutathione in the cells, provides ribose to make ATP in the mitochondria, and the glutathione produced then protects the mitochondria, enhancing ATP production. ATP powers glutathione synthesis, boosting the production. So there is a synergy in the content of ribosine. So no wonder ribosine is 300% better than the next best glutathione precursor, which is NAC. And since glutathione protects mitochondria, no wonder it can protect us from brain disorders, many diseases, and aging, because now many of these are linked to mitochondrial dysfunction. Okay, this is the study that showed that riboside is 300% more effective in raising glutathione compared to NAC. We have two products that are based on riboside. Max One is 100% riboside, and we have Celgevity, which is riboside plus 12 other ingredients, synergistically blended to enhance the body's development of glutathione. But they also have their own health benefits, including anti-aging benefits. So Celgevity is an anti-aging powerhouse. Summary, glutathione for eye, brain, and cognitive function. Glutathione is the main protector of the eyes and brain against damage by oxidative stress, inflammation, and toxins. And therefore, may protect eyes from AMD, cataract, glaucoma, and blindness. May protect us against stroke and enhance the recovery from stroke. Protects from dementia, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, and other neurodegenerative disorders. And can treat psychiatric disorders, anxiety, depression, and schizophrenia. Improves autism and ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and may slow down normal brain aging. Conclusion, glutathione is a tripeptide with many important functions essential for life, good health, and longevity. As the main eye and brain protector, it keeps our eyes and brain healthy and may prevent or delay onset of neurodegenerative disorders. Its antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, and detox functions have been shown in studies to be useful against many brain diseases. Glutathione is produced by our body, but the production declines rapidly after age 20, and this predisposes the body to aging, infections, autoimmunity, neurodegenerative diseases, many other diseases, and cancers, and according to several studies, the COVID-19 as well. We can boost and restore our glutathione to healthy levels. The best way is to take glutathione precursors, and the most efficient precursor available is ribocysteine, or trademarked as ribocine, which is the main ingredient in Max One, and Celgevity. Right? And ribocine is supported by more than 40 peer-reviewed articles. These are the researched articles in journals. Thank you very much.